I am the one who wants to disband the TSA. It's a joke. What we're doing at airports is a colossal waste of billions of dollars, and they've done it again. Can you believe this? There are a number of people, some 70 some of them. Let me get the exact number. 70, how many are there?
73, I believe.
73 aviation employees who they can't identify, and they are potentially linked to terrorism working for TSA.
Well, those employees had been cleared for access to secure airport areas, even though they could have been a threat to travelers' safety. Charlene Aron has that story.
Aviation workers with ties to terrorism working at airports across the country. That's according to a new report by Homeland Security's Inspector General. The report found that 73 aviation workers whose names were listed on the terror watch list and represented a potential transportation security threat were cleared and allowed to work in airports in the U.S.
The audit also revealed that the TSA didn't have effective measures in place to keep prospective employees with criminal histories or illegal status from getting a job at airports in the U.S.
The people in question were employed by major airlines, airport vendors, and other employers. But the TSA failed to identify any link to terrorism during the vetting process because of gaps in accessing the terrorism watch list database. This problem with a breach in TSA security procedures comes just a week after an internal report found shocking failures in airport security. Undercover federal agents had a 95% success rate at sneaking fake bombs and weapons right past TSA checkpoints.
The terrorists do watch this thing. They do watch and go to school on how they can learn from possible vulnerabilities.
The agents were able to smuggle items such as mock explosives and weapons through TSA checkpoints in 67 out of 70 attempts.
Anytime there's a high rate of misses, that causes concern.
Meanwhile, the TSA is now coordinating with the Department of Homeland Security to ensure it has access to all necessary terrorism watch list information. Charlene Aron, CBN News.
It is a joke. It is an absolute joke. And it was just something that's kind of a placebo to make Americans feel, quote, safe when they fly. Well, the idea of letting everybody come through and groping 8-year-olds or 7-year-olds and making grandmothers walk in their stocking feet is just absurd. The Israelis know how to do it. What they have is pre-screening of people. They know who are potential terrorists and who aren't. And the ones who are potential are set aside for careful screening, and everybody else goes on through. But we can't do that. The ACLU says, oh, no, that would be profiling. That's terrible. You can't do that. Well, if you want to keep yourself safe, you might as well identify the people who are going to blow you up and not beat up on little grandmothers. Well, in other news, President Obama says America still doesn't have a strategy, complete strategy, for dealing with Islamic radical or ISIS. John Jessup has that story from our CBN News Bureau in Washington. Here's John.
That's right, Pat. The lack of strategy means the U.S. doesn't have a plan for training Iraqi forces to fight ISIS. The president made that admission at the G7 summit in Germany, nearly a year after American troops started returning to Iraq to help forces there deal with the Islamic State. The president called the militants nimble, aggressive, and opportunistic, and said there still is no plan to defeat them.
When a finalized plan is presented to me by the Pentagon, then I will share it with the American people. It's not, we don't yet have a complete strategy.
Some Republicans say the problem is President Obama himself and that his muddled and ineffective response is losing the battle against ISIS. Pat?
It's shocking. The Pentagon says, listen, we have given you many plans and you haven't acted on any of them. The Pentagon has plans. But ladies and gentlemen, we had what was called a surge, and everybody objected to it except the Bush administration put it through, and General Petraeus was the one who was the architect, I believe, of that surge strategy. And we had thousands of troops, 40,000 or so of them, in Iraq, and they took the battle to the well, the left, the other forces, and defeated them soundly. And then what happened is from 40,000 or so, we reduced it to 4,000. We don't have any presence over there. Obama cut and run and ran, and we've got the results because the militants began to proliferate immediately because there's nobody there to stop them. As long as we had troops, trainers, support people embedded with the Iraqi forces did fine. Took our people out, the Iraqi forces fell apart. It's just the way it is. And we have allowed ISIS to build up in Syria. We have allowed ISIS to build up in Iraq. They've almost taken over all of Iraq, at least the important part of Anbar province. They have certainly taken over the better parts of Syria. And we have done nothing about it. And for our president to say that we haven't yet come to a strategy is just absurd. What has he been doing? We've had years to think about this stuff. And he still doesn't have the reason. Is he won't call ISIS what it is. He won't call them Islamic terrorists, and he won't try to destroy them. What he says, I'm going to contain them, he doesn't know what he's talking about. And it's terrible to be in the grip of somebody who is ineffective as this man is. John?
Pat, as ISIS continues its advance through Syria and Iraq, thousands of refugees and shattered lives are left in its wake. But some Christians have been able to get away. And now they're trying to rebuild their lives. Chris Mitchell brings us that story from Amman, Jordan.
For Amar and his family, the bell tolled at midnight.
Very strange bells ring in this time. And loudspeakers call us, all of you go out from Karakosh. ISIS is coming and there is no one to protect you. So I take my family, my wife, my children, and go.
Like the rest of those in the Christian village of about 60,000, Amman's family fled for their lives. Many headed to Erbil, the capital of Kurdistan. Others escaped to Dahuk, a major Kurdish city near the Turkish border. Months later, some have made it to Amman, Jordan's capital, and its surrounding towns.
Until now, we can't even imagine this happening to us. It's like a dream. Everything was so normal. Our life was so comfortable, and suddenly everything changed.
Changed by terrorists with a deadly goal.
They don't want any Christians to live in Iraq. They want to kill them all or have them leave or become a Muslim.
But they escaped and gave the credit to God.
Jesus made for us. The miracle is save my family. I have a wife and three daughters. Yeah. Jesus saved them from ISIS.
While they're still without a country, these families fared better than most. They live in a nice apartment, thanks to help from an Anglican priest known as the Vicar of Baghdad. His name is Canon Andrew White. His organization provides homes and other help for refugees.
We need provision, but we also need protection, because each of us has come from such a violent place. I doubt whether there's a child in this class who has not had their loved ones killed.
Many Iraqi Christians have fled and found refuge here in Jordan. And most of the school children here have come from Mosul, ancient Nineveh, or the surrounding Christian villages and towns in northern Iraq. And nearly everyone here has fled because of ISIS. The school brought hope.
They had nothing. And now they have structure to their life and hope for the future.
Through all the trauma and heartache, their faith remains firm.
In the United States and the West, people need to know that these people have nothing, but they have everything. Because they know that Yeshua, Jesus, is real and central to their lives.
The children continue to sing the Lord's Prayer in Aramaic. Families continue to read their Bibles, and given the choice to deny the Lord, They refused.
He died for us on the cross. I can't deny Jesus. I can't deny him.
For now, they look to the UN and other nations for help, and to the church for prayer.
Pray for us. We are in a very hard situation here. Me, I am good. But there are so many people living in camps in Erbil, in Iraq. Here in Jordan, the life is very difficult. Especially here in Jordan, there is no work. We're not allowed to work, the Iraqi people. So we want them to pray for us.
Chris Mitchell, CBN News, Amman, Jordan.
Thanks, Chris. Pat, talk about standing for your faith.
Well, it humbles us to think of people like that. I mean, we haven't yet been called upon to suffer that way, those of us who live in the United States. We haven't had anything like their suffering. But ISIS is determined to destroy them, and we understand that they have captured a number of other Christians in Libya and are attempting to, they will behead them in a big public display. It just breaks your heart to see the brutality that is being done. And it's being done, I might add, in the name of Allah. It's being done in the name of the Quran. It's being done in the name of the Prophet Muhammad. This is authentic. Islam. That's what it says. Behead those and don't make them your friends. That's what is said in the Quran, and that's the way they're living it out. But it just breaks your heart to see those precious little children and their families being uprooted, have no hope right now of a livelihood, dependent on doles from various governments, and driven out of their homes because of this evil religious political system that is spreading like cancer in the Middle East. John?
Pat, Americans born in Jerusalem can no longer list Israel as their country of birth on their passports now that the Supreme Court struck down a law that had allowed them to do that. The court ruled 6-3 that Congress overstepped its authority when it approved a passport law back in 2002. Justice Anthony Kennedy wrote in his majority opinion that the president has the exclusive power to recognize foreign nations. But Chief Justice John Roberts and Antonin Scalia disagreed. The key question in the case involves the status of Jerusalem. The U.S. does not recognize it as Israel's capital and says the city's status should be resolved between Israel and the Palestinians. Well, former Fed Chairman Alan Greenspan is warning that the U.S. is way underestimating the national debt, which currently stands at $18 trillion. Speaking at a fiscal summit by the Peter G. Peterson Foundation, Greenspan said the government is committed to paying for pensions it can't afford. And he said there's no trust funds for Social Security. The Daily Caller reports Greenspan said the notion that we have a trust fund is nonsense. Other financial experts agree, warning the national debt is much higher when the costs of Social Security and Medicare are included. Pat, what do you think? Do you agree?
Of course I agree. I must say that Greenspan didn't exactly read off my playbook, but I've been saying it for the longest kind of time. There is no Social Security trust fund. Remember Al Gore talking about a lockbox? There is no money in it. There's never been any money in it. They spend out of the current income that comes into the federal government, and a portion of that goes to pay for retirees. There's no trust fund. It is an imaginary amount that is covered by United States government bonds, but the bonds have to be backed up by tax dollars. It's the same thing, so it's just putting debt, they say. These bonds go into a so-called trust fund, but it's just an illusory thing, and Alan Greenspan's telling the truth. But he's sending some alarming signals that our debt is vastly higher than what we've been claiming. And it's one of those things that will burden down. Whether it'll bring our country to its knees, I don't know, but the day of reckoning is not that far away.